What's going on, everybody? Welcome to the Alex Quest, the show. How's everybody doing out there on this Thursday, January 11th of 2024? You are listening to episode 106. Before we get into the fun stuff, David's over there being stupid. Hi, David.
Hi. Hi, hello. A lot of things have happened recently in the news and personally, so I'm having a good time.
What's happened to you?
Nothing. I'm making conversation. It's a show. I'm supposed to add things to it.
I mean, just don't be useful.
You just yes and you keep going. Things. That's all you need to do.
All right. I'm going to keep going. Wow. Yeah. Lectured. You're so aggressive. So anyway, if you like what you hear today, like, follow, subscribe, give us a 5-star rating, Spotify and iTunes. Spread this word of mouth. Find us on the socials at the Alex Quest the Show. So David's rude. That's our first news of the day. Number two, though, if you've been following us and if you have tried to go find us on iTunes and Apple Podcasts, you might have been really confused because you've searched the Alex Quest the Show, but the avatar is still said the old show, the median, and that show doesn't exist anymore. But now after contacting Apple supports, they've actually got the new logo up. And yes, new logo. We have a cool new logo. So go check it out. And you'll see the proper thing there. So the confusion should now be over. You can go find us on Apple Podcasts there. Go search the Alex Quest Show. We'll pop up. Before we get into the show tonight, last week's show, we had a great show. Attorney Andrew Branca came on, law of self-defense. He's outside of being really good, he's absolutely hilarious because he just doesn't give a shit. And had a real good show, broke down a lot of good things of self-defense, good things that you might want to know and need to know. If you ever find yourself in a situation where you either need to defend yourself or want to defend somebody else, go listen to that show. So because you might want to reconsider helping other people. This is like the Seinfeld thing. Like, don't be a good Samaritan. Like, don't do it. But, if you haven't seen the last episode of Seinfeld, watch the whole show because it's worth it. It's a great show. Anyway. So let's jump into this week's show. This one's exciting for me because I actually didn't realize I had this individual on 5 years ago on my first ever podcast that I did, first ever show, Sports Opinions Podcast. That one was all talking sports, and I'm going to give everyone some inside baseball. He's the guy that told me what mic to get because I needed a cheap mic. I wanted to start a podcast. I knew he did some things on YouTube with doing some funny skits. And I was like, hey, I just want to get a mic. And he's like, get this one. It's cheap. It sounds decent. It did. It sounded good for the time, what I needed. Obviously, we upgraded. But he is a good buddy of mine and Dave's, another Manchester Township alum, currently doing some awesome freaking stuff in California. He is Craig Leppert, chairman and founder of Shadow Jumpers and an entertainment executive. What is going on, my brother?
Hey, I'm happy 5 years later. I'm happy to see everyone's face, everyone's voice. It's great to be here. Thank you guys for having me.
Absolutely. You know, unfortunately, we added David to the show, so you have to see David. It's a negative, but you know, you got to counterbalance, right? We can't have only two positives. You got to get the negative in there or something. So
yeah, a little bad to just remind you about the good.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. No, he's just actually there to make fun of me. And whenever I'm wrong, which is often, point it out about like 10 minutes later in the show. Yeah. So if you hear me say something you think isn't factual, David will more than likely point it out later. So I want to jump into the show right away because if people didn't listen 5 years ago, hopefully they hear about it now because you have an awesome charity that you do. Now, first off, the charity's named Shadow Jumpers. Talk about the charity and why you started it, because you have something about you that people may not know about.
Yes. So for you guys, if you listening at home, I ponder the question to you of think about the last couple weeks of your life and all the things you might have done outside. You probably drove your car to work. You probably got some groceries, ran some errands. Maybe you sat outside, took in the sun or ate lunch outside. You know, just that little amount of time that you spent outside for a small portion of families in America, that little amount of time would lead to severe pain, second degree burns, and in some extreme cases, skin cancer. So Shadow Jumpers is a nonprofit I created that essentially acts as a make-a-wish for those families and young people in the United States And we started because I suffer from one of those disorders myself. I suffer from erythropoietic protoporphyria. You could just call it EPP to save you the tongue twister. And to oversimplify it, my body makes too much protoporphyrin. You do too at times. Your body breaks that down through the liver, gets rid of it. But the assembly line of protoporphyrin to my liver is just so overdue that there's no way to break it all down. So the body stores it in the skin. And when that hits by sunlight, it burns apart. You know, it's a one in a million genetic rare disorder. So basically, long story short, and the end of 2017, kind of came up with the idea of, you know, helping young people get outside and realize you can do more things despite your disorder. So since then, we've raised over $100,000, helped various kids in various ways across the United States. I'm very proud of it so far.
Yeah. And, you know, it's funny because when I really met Craig, it was summer football. We were doing summer practices and I really didn't know Craig. And here comes this dude. I believe you were a freshman when I was a senior, right? Were you one of our freshmen there? Yep. You were there. You, Jimmy Lawson and Josh Emanowicz were the only freshmen that were going to play varsity ball. And this kid shows up and I kind of knew about him, but he's decked out in Under Armour, gloves, a visor, the whole works. And I'm like, what the hell's going on here? And they're like, dude, he's allergic to the sun. I'm like, get the fuck out of here. Allergic to the sun? And they're like, yeah. And then the coaches are setting up tents. And little did you know, like, Craig was one of the hardest working dudes out there and never wanted to come out. And you would just like see him and you would know it. There would be like, we would drag him under the tent and be like, stay. We would like treat him like a dog and be like, you're going to start in linebacker. Stop it. Stay right here. He was so nervous at losing his spot that he never wanted to come out. And, you know, and you went through it. And I just remember that year driving you home a good amount of times and you were just in freaking pain, but you always had a smile. It was crazy. You always tried to mask it and not let it control what you did and what you didn't do. And is that another reason why you wanted to do Shadow Jumpers, to show these kids, to show these families that there really isn't anything that they can't do?
Yeah, of course. I always tell people the seed that sparked my interest to make Shadow Jumpers was I moved out here to California to pursue a career in television and film and all that stuff. And I had written on Facebook at the time, everyone overshared on Facebook, you know, moving to California, going to chase my dream, yada, yada, yada. And I was in a lot of Facebook groups for sun disorder people. And at that time, the response was really weird. It was like, why would you do that? I can't believe you would try to do that. You know, the sun is so strong. Why would you put yourself through that? And I kind of just logged that in the back of my mind. And then a couple of years later, you know, Facebook again on another group chat. And you saw there was a mother who had posted a story about her son, and her son had EPP and he wanted to be a mechanic. And for whatever reason, the entry level for that job for him was he had to park the cars at the local mechanics shop. And the family thought because of that compound sun exposure over a day, he just wasn't going to be able to do it. And she posted this long thing about, you know, my son has to give up his dream. Kid's like 16 years old, 17 mm-hmm. years old.
Yeah.
And all the comments on Facebook were like, yes, like it's so difficult. Like he can't do this. He shouldn't even try. And so I tell people I had a sliding doors moment. I could have sat there and become a keyboard warrior, you know, and take on like 200 people I didn't know, like Jon Snow, Battle of the Bastards style. Or I could do what I did, which I closed my laptop and I just thought of like, what could I have done to change that family's perspective? And that's really what it is. It's you know, there's no, for me, it's being like, I never had a feel down about myself moment or feel bad about the sun because it's all I knew. And I think that's hard for people to understand. And I think sometimes for young people, you start to measure yourself up against what other people have and the life of the people live. And you kind of use that as justification to not pursue the bigger things in life.
Mm-hmm.
So Shadow Jumpers kind of came out of, if you pulled away all the no's a kid could say, would he look at his disorder differently? And that's kind of what we're trying to do for young people.
And, you know, it's a cool thing too. And I guess it's not cool because you obviously have EPP.
It's cool. Vampires are
yeah,
are cool.
But you were also on Mystery Diagnosis many moons ago because you have EPP, but you were born in Hawaii. Your mom and dad, you were in Hawaii, right, as a kid. And they found out because you were coming around like scratching your arms and they had no idea what the hell's going on. So, you know, talk about like, you know, your childhood and stuff. And you eventually came over to the Jersey Shore, where we're all from now, Manchester, because I'm pretty sure your parents didn't want to give up the beach, but they also wanted to get into like a four season climate as well.
Yeah. I was born, in Hawaii. I grew up on the Jersey Shore and, lived in Los Angeles. It doesn't make any sense to me either. I was born there. I actually moved, the story's right. The location's just a little off. I was born in Hawaii. My father was in the army. Mm-hmm. We moved to Maryland, living like on the shore there. And when I was 18 months, I was in a kiddie pool outside of our apartment and just started going nuts, scratching my face and hands. I couldn't communicate. I think I got dosed with Benadryl at like 18 months old that day. Woke up the next day, hands looked like little boxing gloves. Jesus. And really for the next like 3 or 4 years, which is actually very common for people with EPP, is no one could diagnose what was wrong with me. So we started a cross-off checklist of what this could be. So we went to doctors who said he's allergic to detergent, he's allergic to chlorine. One doctor was like, he's allergic to hydrogen in the air. I wonder what that wacko is doing these days. He's probably on the Pat McAfee show. But then we moved to New Jersey, again, stationed in my parents grew up in New Jersey, so wanted to move back home. And just by the grace of God, met a pediatrician who had gone to a rare disorder conference or something like that the week before, had heard of EPP and started the process to get a diagnosis. My mom always tells the story, you know, at that time there was no real cell phones and internet. So she went to a library and found, you know, a paragraph in an encyclopedia about EPP. And it's hard because, you know, you're so relieved to finally have an answer, but then you're so shocked at what you think the life you're son's gonna live.
I mean, you did have some perks. You were like the only kid in Jersey allowed to have all your windows tinted. Like you would come in, your whole car, your car just fully murdered out. Just like, it's like you had to, like you didn't have a choice, but it was like tints. And anyone knows in Jersey, like it's like a 0.01 tint allowed, like everywhere, all around, doesn't matter where it is. And here comes Craig and it's just like Knight Rider coming in over here with his car. So I guess there are minor perks to it.
The best perk was I never had to go out for a fire drill.
That's true too.
Yeah.
Yeah, but then the worst part of that was we had a bomb threat in the high school and we evacuated to the middle school and I got left behind at the middle school or at the high school. I was like, oh, this is a long ass fire drill for like 2 hours.
Who got fired for that one? That is,
I don't know.
That's an absolute, I never heard that story.
Yeah, it was like 2 hours is probably an exaggeration, but it was like 45 minutes.
Of yeah, probably
like,
get them out.
Are they ever, maybe there is a fire and I should
maybe I just go hide in the woods at this point. Like we had woods all around, you'd have been fine. Oh my God. I never heard that story. So yeah.
There's perks there. Like I also have a handicap license plate, which makes such a big deal in Los Angeles. I don't have to catch myself. You know, I'll be driving around to try to find parking. I'm like, oh, there's not enough effing handicap spots. And my girlfriend will be like, we're not really handicapped. Like these are going to people who deserve it. You know? So I like to try to have a hitch in my step when I walk to Ralph.
Yeah. you have a cane for all occasions. Just bring out a cane at all times.
Yeah.
So go over some of the highlights that you remembered for some of the things you've done in some of the families that Shadow Jumpers does. Like what have been some of your favorite things to do for families and for kids?
Yeah, well, just dating back to the last time we spoke on a podcast, I always remember 2017, 2018, when we had no money, no idea what we were doing. You know, our big thing at that time was we sent families to Disney World, all expenses paid and sunproof. And that was really cool. VIP experience. These Disney people, they curate a whole thing for you. They take you in and out of the park in like a SUV. You can go underground if you need, whatever it needs to help you burn daylight per se. And that was really cool. But what we ran into with that was people had to apply and you only picked one family a year. So it kind of felt like there was losers that didn't win.
Yeah.
And then we evolved, you know, more money, more experience, more exposure. Mm-hmm. And we were able to kind of do what we do now, which is a make a wish, submit the request to us. really, we fall into three kinds of experiences. So we help families redo failed experiences and vacations they tried. Just recently, we sent a kid to Myrtle Beach who's obsessed with seashells.
Nice.
You know, kids like the simplest things. Went to the beach on his own a couple years ago, got destroyed by the sun. So all expenses paid, set him up with protective clothing. We're able to drive right up onto the beach, all these tents, and Myrtle Beach is like known for seashells. So got in and got out.
That's awesome.
No problems whatsoever. We were able to, you know, we cover medical expenses related to sun disorder. So we just helped a family last year in Northern California. Suffered from CEP, and they were about, you know, $5,000-$6,000 behind on their living expenses and medical bills. Paid all that, and we also gave them like $1,000 for a good Christmas morning, which was awesome. Most recently, we renovated this awesome girl in Wisconsin's basement. Her name's Addison. She's 12 years old. She suffers from EPP, but there's a side effect of, or a rare complication of, liver failure from EPP. Like we said earlier, your body tries to break this thing down through the liver. And for some reason, for some people, it just builds up. So this 12-year-old, you know, was in stage 5 liver failure. And what we come to find out is she's going through treatment and she's spending all her, you know, downtime in her room, which is just getting beat by sunlight and heat all day. And their basement wasn't up to par. And as an EPPer myself, like, having a basement is such a sanctuary, right? If you get burned, you can disappear and be
I just remember you telling us the stories after practice, like you would go right to the basement, strip down, get an ice bath and just sit there and be in this in pain, which is like, it sucks. Like,
And you're up till 2 a.m. You don't want to wake up other people so you can be by yourself.
Yeah.
So we went under a huge renovation. We renovated this whole basement to be bathroom, bedroom, common area. And then we're excited. We found out in this process, she was a huge San Jose Sharks fan, which, put your hand up if you ever met one of those before, you can. But we got in touch with the Sharks a couple months ago, and they've been amazing. And the whole family's flying out to San Jose next week, and they're going to be part of a team skate, meet the team, and be like guests of honor per se at a game on Saturday. Personally, I'm really excited. I live in Los Angeles, so I've never met any of our Shadow Jumper kids. Mm-hmm. So I'm actually flying up to meet them on next Friday, which will be really cool.
That's cool.
And, you know, we have a bunch of other stuff that we're really excited about coming up that we can't talk about yet. It's still processing. I will say, a cool just blanket thing that we do, we started last year, is we do a UV protective clothing drive. So a lot of these garments, you know, hats, gloves, face coverings, bathing suits, the really good stuff is like $50-$60 a garment. So you're paying, as a parent, probably $200 to clothe your child. And I don't have kids, but, you know, you would know, kids grow exponentially fast.
They grow fast, and you buy one thing 1 week and the next week you got to buy it again, like something new. It's awful.
So what we found is, you know, all those garments and all that money is just going into a draw to never be seen from again.
Mm-hmm.
But what we do is, we have those parents send us those garments, we kind of log them, and we send them to parents who can't afford the high-end stuff. So that's been awesome. A really new thing. And then this coming year, outside of a couple of things, we want to focus on parents. You know, we just talked about, you know, wanting to change the mindset of kids and looking at their disorder. You know, over time, you start to realize a lot of those handcuffs are put on by parents.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of these disorders are genetic. A lot of them are, you feel bad that you've given something to your child, even though you as a parent don't have symptoms. So we're trying to get a lot more of parents talking to parents, and not like, oh, you should, you know, tint your car, but it's saying, you know, what do you mentally think when you have to let your child go outside and get burned and mm-hmm. kind of let them learn the hard way. So it's trying to have the conversations that maybe your doctor can't have with you to be a better parent.
How big are your parents in that process? Because your parents are absolutely incredible. You know, your mom and dad are two of the nicest people you will meet. You know, they're just awesome. Every time I've ever met them, they've always been great. How big have your parents been in that process? Were they some of the people that kind of, did you run that by them first before, like, you know, have you talked to them about what they went through? Because your sister also has EPP, right? So, you know, there's two of you in there. And so what has that been like? Did you talk to them about this before you did it? Are they participating?
they will be forced into participating. I've kind of teed it up to them. They've been really supportive. The name Shadow Jumpers does come from them. That was the name that my parents kind of, the slogan or however you want to word it, gave up to me and my sister when we would go on family vacations to California, to Florida. We would run and kind of figuratively jump from shadow to shadow to minimize our sun exposure. But, you know, as more time goes on and the more parents I've met, the more appreciative I am of my mom and dad, because you just see how hard it is to really let your son or daughter go out and experience the sun. And really, you know, there's a lot of times that, you know, my parents never said, "I told you so." They just kind of sat there with me and let me work through the pain. And, you know, they're the benchmark for what I think EPP parents should be. So when we get in that process, and, you know, they're going to be the first interview we do to try to just get as many answers as we can from them.
That's fantastic. And, you know, and anyone that's listening that maybe, you know, listens to Shadow Jumpers, so they know you and they're listening to this, Craig, you know, going to high school with him and like seeing that, he was the popular kid in school. Like you can have, but I'm not even kidding. Like you can have a very, not only normal, but excel, right? Because you were a good, really good athlete. You were good in class. You were also liked by universally most people. You know, I think people that didn't like you were kind of jealous because, you know, you could dance. You know, you're a decent looking dude. Like you had a lot, but you can, you know,
over here hitting on him.
Yeah, oh, I always hit on Craig. I've been hitting on Craig since I met him, okay?
I'm going to start the podcast back every time I'm down the next 6 months.
but really, like, you can, like, and this is not only for EPP, this is for anything. Like, you could pick yourself up. There's no reason to ever stay down. Craig had every single reason to just kind of put his head in the sand and just be like, I'm just going to go home every day and sit in my basement and wallow and not do anything, but... I mean, if you didn't know outside of like playing a sport with Craig that had to be outdoors, you really had no idea that Craig had any sort of difference to him at all. The only time is when I used him to get an A in health class because I didn't do my project at all. And I had him just come talk about EPP because I'm that type of friend. But but yeah, no. So I want to talk about something you have coming up on February 3rd. Annual spin away the sun. What is that? How can people help and donate?
Yeah, so on Saturday, February 3rd, Shadow Jumpers is going to have its fourth annual Spin Away the Sun event. It's a really fancy way for us to say a spinathon. For those of you who don't know, a spinathon is a lot like a walkathon or a bikeathon. Whereas those events have participants going a certain number of miles. Spinathon is all about time. We'll be in a spin studio on a stationary bike for 2.5 hours. It is the best, worst thing you'll ever do. Yeah. And we, you know, what we do is we, you know, our riders reach out to their friends, family, coworkers, podcast listeners, and ask if they'd like to support and back that ride with a donation. Every dollar raised in this process goes towards our mission of helping, you know, sun disorder families have a better life despite their circumstances around the sun. If you'd like to give a donation, that'd be very kind of you. You can go to our website and right on the top is our link to Spin Away the Sun where you can make a donation and kind of follow our journey. We're trying to go for a new milestone of $50,000. Last year, we were so appreciative to raise $29,000. We're excited to be at $26,000 already. So hopefully we finish strong. What we find in these things is most of our money's raised in a panic the last 2 weeks. So we got to feel good about where we are right now.
Yeah. and you know, and overall, like, I don't think Craig stated that there is a danger to, you know, a porphyria in the whole spectrum, right? Like there is generally, if I'm not mistaken, a shortened lifespan expected with a lot of it because of the potential liver complications and things like that, right? That you go through with all that.
Yes, for certain porphyrias, EPP being a little bit safer on that side, but XLP, CEP, these are, you know, very tough lives that some of these people can live. You know, we say we want to get out there and live life. It's definitely without white knuckling through some moments in life, but there can be some tough moments for people, just as, you know, Addison, our Wisconsin girl's liver failure is very dangerous. And you know, that she's not the only one out there dealing with those complications.
So if you're, you know, if you're listening to this and you're thinking about it, it's not just a typical allergy. Like it is something that can be very difficult to live with and potentially deadly. So if you're giving to this charity, you're giving to a good cause. You're giving to a cause to not only help people go and have enjoyment, but like Craig said, they help pay for medical bills. They'll help renovate homes so that they fit better. So, you know, if you're looking at and you're thinking of donating to something like a St. Jude, which is a great charity, or donating to like cancer or something like that, also consider donating to Shadow Jumpers, because I think they are right in line with the other things that those groups do, where they are trying to help people live better lives, overcome some really tough circumstances. So definitely consider go donate, even if you don't donate to the Spinathon, donate to Shadow Jumpers in general. And next time it's your birthday, when you do your little fundraiser thing that everyone does on Facebook, do Shadow Jumpers and get them some money, because it's a good cause. And it's not just because it's my buddy, Craig. It's because it's, you know, the right thing to do for those people. So we appreciate what you do over there, brother.
Thanks. I will tell people of, you know, every charity is important and everyone needs your money. But with Shadow Jumpers, if you'd like to be interested in us, you know, there's so little families out there in the United States that have these disorders that you really can see exactly where your money's going and the impact that you can have on these kids and change their lives, as opposed to maybe St. Jude's, which is amazing, that you know, it kind of goes into a bigger system. And for us, you can really see every year, these are the four or five families that we've been able to impact.
Definitely, definitely. So that's our spiel. We're going to jump to something new though, because, you know, it is funny. You mentioned you're out in California and you're an entertainment executive. So what exactly are you doing over there hanging out in the sun? And, you know, what type of behind the scenes skinny can you give us with what you do in your job?
It's been an eventful few years, in entertainment with COVID and strikes. You know, I say right now, like with the aftermath of the strike, it kind of feels like the aftermath of COVID, where, you know, for a large part of this year, things grinded to a halt. And yes, we're back into doing things, but you're kind of seeing the aftermath of being at a standstill for work. A lot of stuff being pushed a year, year and a half. My job kind of feels like it changes with each project, each passing month. I think the last 2 months, I'm sorry, 2 years, the big part of my job has been looking at the projects we have in development for scripted or unscripted television and filling behind the scenes of that. So, you know, we have a show that's gone to series on CBS. We needed to fill that room with writers. We needed to slot directors. I'll go out to agencies and managers around town. I'll get a sense of who's available on their client list, who's interested, and then kind of act as the middleman in the first vetting process of pitching that over to our team and then relaying who we like and then eventually filing the paperwork for those people to come on board.
So Craig is the first Vanguard gatekeeper. If you want to get into their projects, you got to get through Craig. You got to impress him, damn it. He's that like big hulking figure at like every like big thing at the gate. Get through me first. Yeah. So that's got to be fun. So you have to meet a lot of different characters too, right? And a lot of different people that are coming in depending on the project. So what are some projects that you have worked on? Or, you know, I think last time you were part of So Help Me Todd, and that is coming back, right? It survived the COVID strikes and everything and all that. So that's coming back, right? That has another season coming up.
Yeah. So our production company here, we're very proud. We produce So Help Me Todd for CBS. First season was a roller coaster of just COVID and trying to shoot in Vancouver. And we were very successful to finish strong and get a season two. So we're in production. We're going to start season two will premiere February 15th. And again, because of the strike, it's usually for broadcast, you get about 18 to 22 episodes. I think we're coming in between 10 and 12. I got to double check, but very proud about that. And, you know, and this, it's so funny in entertainment, there's so many companies and sometimes we're like one of those where you can make a living of selling stuff that never gets on television. So there's a lot of projects that we're working on at the moment that, you know, maybe get sold to a network and in the process, it doesn't make it on TV, but you're able to keep going. So there's a lot of that. There's a lot of books that we're looking at the moment. Mm-hmm. It feels like, you know, every 6 months you're, you know, what people want changes. So you're just trying to get in as fast as you can.
So talk about the strike a little bit, because you guys fell into the unfortunate thing where you had a strike and then another strike, right? It was back to back kind of. So you talked about COVID, you talked about the strikes. It looks like Hollywood is kind of reeling right now. You know, they're slowly coming back, but there hasn't been as many blockbuster hits, right? This year we saw, you know, Oppenheimer, Barbie, but it's like the superhero genre is way down. They're not doing what they do, like, and kind of it's self-inflicted, right? Because I think some of their writing has been pretty terrible. But you're looking at the schedule for next year, and I think like the release number is like way down as well. So is that something that maybe is going to be permanent with like how theaters are going, and are we going to, and streaming, are we going to see less and less, or are you seeing this with what you've seen in the industry as just kind of a blip in the radar? Everyone needs to re-get their bearings, and then we're going to start to see more things pumped out again.
Yeah, I think that you're starting to see, you know, if you look back at like the peak of this movement, the where we are now, if you were at the bottom, if you were to look at the peak, mm-hmm. I think it was like 2018, 2019.
Yeah, 2018, 2019 was fantastic. Yeah. Would you have like $4 billion, $5 billion, like $5 billion movies or something like that?
It was that Infinity War? I can't remember when the hell. There was Endgame, one of them. Yeah, that year, that was crazy.
Yeah, there was a big number of like $1 billion movies worldwide that year.
Yeah, and I think what you've seen is the pivot from that was, yes, COVID, but there was a lot of move into everyone needs to go into streaming. Streaming is going to be this big thing. No one's going to leave their house anymore. And I think what you saw was everyone got a little bloated. Streaming was buying everything. There was you know, people were making movies that you'll never see or never hear of.
Making deals with like Adam Sandler to make six movies, and you like find like one of them to be decent. Like they're not. And
his on Netflix are probably more watching a lot of other ones on Netflix.
They are, but it's like it's tough. But they're like a lot of them, like they're not good. They're like made for TV movies. They don't have that same, but they're supposed to have that same value, right? It's like kind of weird.
Yeah, so what I think what's happened, or what has happened to this point, is you there's just so much, there's so many options that you have no options. You're almost paralyzed by choice. And so what I think what you're seeing is everything's starting to contract. And I think you're going to go back to a little bit more appointment television of like, let's make six series a year that really pop and we can really get behind. Me and my friends were joking the other day because there seems to be such a hard pivot by streamers to try to get into sports. Yes. And it's like, no duh, that's what's kept cable alive for years. It's like the joke of like, there's a Uber holds an emergency meeting and some young kid is like, I have an idea. What if we get a really big car that goes the same route every day and picks people up? And it's like, that's a bus, you fucker. And so it kind of feels like, you know, next thing you know, there's going to be a company that's like, hey, we'll one price, we'll give you all of these apps for, you know, one price of $6.99. That's just cable all over again.
Yeah, I think
we tried to reinvent the wheel. I don't think it necessarily worked.
Yep.
I think the other thing that's worth noting that we're kind of coming out of, or the fog in our industry has cleared, is I think right before COVID and a little bit in COVID, there was a big move of, you know, if you have 4 million TikTok subscribers, if you have 400 million Twitter followers, if we put you in a TV show or a movie, it's going to be a huge hit. And none of that has ever translated. No. I think part of that is because those people aren't meant to be actors. They aren't meant to be. So the product wasn't very good. But I think you're starting to see people kind of realize the numbers and the impressions online and social media don't necessarily reflect what people want to watch on linear television. So I don't know how to crack that code. But I think that's the one like magic bullet still to find, is how to take this younger generation that's on TikTok and is kind of digesting their material and their entertainment differently and get them on the television.
Yeah, I think that bridges into what I really wanted to ask about, was the shift in who's watching what through the generations. Because, I mean, especially you look at our nephews, especially you look at Billy and Christopher and what they're watching. Yeah. They're not watching TV most of the time. Yeah. If they're watching sports, they're like streamers on YouTube or on Twitch or something like that. And I mean, it's anecdotal, but every time I hear about what kids are watching, they're not watching cartoons. Like, they're not really watching that. They might. But most of the time they're watching streamers, they're watching Let's Plays, they're just watching things on YouTube. And I want to know if that's been like slightly, like you brought up with like TikTok followers and them getting on shows. But is that just an issue in general of like, how do you reach those, the people that don't necessarily want to watch a lot of narrative things, at least with the way that it seems to go right now?
Yeah, I think, you know, The simple answer is like no one knows yet. I think the way I look at the that space and TikTok and stuff is a lot how I think of what VR is in our space right now. You know, obviously kids are on there and there's the Oculus, but I think for linear storytelling, you'll probably never really watch a movie on there. But if you watched, you know, just coming to my head, Indiana Jones, you could probably go on the VR and have a secondary experience already having knowledge of the movie. Yeah. So I think maybe TikTok and stuff like that will bridge the gap of how can we make money off of people kind of seeing 20, you know, right now, Warner Brothers is going to post 25 seconds of every Soprano episode on TikTok as a 25th anniversary. So I think it's finding ways of, you know, shorten clips of like using that as just like a secondary avenue stream, a revenue stream to just try to get more people. But I think what's happened is, you know, there was days where if you had a show on broadcast TV, you would open up Entertainment Weekly and you would look at the ratings and it was 30 million, 25 million, 10 million. That's now like you're in 5 million on, you know, so we're kind of looking at numbers differently and what is success differently. So I'm interested to see where it goes. I think you're going to see just, again, less shows and more of here's the five things to watch and we're all going to love them and we're all going to pump that way.
Hopefully. I just want to say this. And like with like TikTok and, you know, you said the Sopranos are putting out 25 second clips of it. It does seem like some of the content we've been getting TV show wise and movie wise lately where they're not very well put together, but it seems like they're trying to go for certain scenes where you could put it on Twitter and you can get a lot of hits from it. You can put it on TikTok and get a lot of hits. Like, oh, that looks so cool. I might check that movie out. Most of the time I don't.
Well, I mean, it's like,
oh, I might check
Euphoria,
it out.
That Euphoria wasn't a good show.
I would say a lot more people watched that though. I'm just talking about like The Flash. The Flash got clips on Twitter. I saw people posting them and talking about them, but not a lot of people watched The Flash. It was a bomb.
Yeah, I mean, I think like, right, well, when's the last time you watched the VMAs and knew everyone that was getting an award? Yep. You know, I think the hard part too is that we're at the age now where we're not the demographic that's being anything made for anymore.
Doesn't the Oscars have like 12 options now though? Like it's something ridiculous where it used to be like the five nominees. Now they have like 10 or 12 nominees for best picture. I think it's something ridiculous.
I don't watch it.
Yeah. I think I read it somewhere that they're like upping it to like 10 or 12 nominees. So it's like, it's kind of like now the exclusivity, because if I'm not mistaken, don't most streaming services outside of Netflix like operate on a loss? So it's like they're not really making much money off of what they do. And like you said, they're all kind of starting to box themselves in, right? Like Disney is eating up everything. So eventually we're just going to be watching Disney cable because they're just like eating up everything. And it's like, and you really are. I think in the end, if you have like all the streaming services plus in the internet, you're paying more than you did with cable. So do you ever see like a form of cable coming back? Not even just with all these apps coming back together, but eventually people starting to look and going like, kind of liked having 300 channels at my disposal and then choosing to have HBO or choosing to have these extra things. Like, do you see that coming back at all?
The couple ways I see it is like, I do think that we're just going to get a version of bundled apps together, especially, well, you kind of have it now with like the Disney bundle with Hulu and ESPN and Disney Plus. You know, kind of going back before, if sports is the one thing left that still drives price.
Ooh, and it has live sports. Yeah.
Yeah. But I mean, look at this weekend, just how many people are going to bite the bullet and pay $6.99 to watch Peacock Saturday night for the playoff game. And it's, they got you by the balls and they know it. And I think that's the last thing. And what you're going to see with the Peacock scenario this weekend, which I think is a good example of what I perceive is going to happen. You're going to have so many apps and you can't afford all this. So you're going to, you're going to swap them in and out. Like, oh, you want to watch Breaking Bad this month? We'll pay $6.99 to watch Breaking Bad and then churn off of it. So I think you're just going to get to a point where once someone tells you like, oh, you got to watch this thing on Netflix, you almost treat it like you're going to the movies before a month, you know?
Do you ever see like an a la carte service where it'll be like David's video streamer where like you could say, okay, I want to watch Breaking Bad. That's on Peacock. I'm going to pay 99 cents per episode to Peacock, but it's going to come through this service type of deal where you don't have to have Peacock, but you can just pay for it to access Peacock into that like one all-encompassing app that can pull from all the other streaming services. You just kind of pay a la carte.
Maybe. That's kind of what like iTunes was back in the day when you could buy episodes.
Absolutely. Yep.
I don't know. I think that people are just so protective now of like their content. Like the big thing, you know, an oversimplification of the writer strike was basically like there used to be a time when you had a hit TV show on, say, CBS, and you were so excited to get to 100 episodes because then you went into syndication. Yeah. And that's when you made, you know, the majority of your wealth for the next 50 years. Now places like CBS or NBC, they're like, no, we're just going to kind of give you a lump sum now that's nothing that you might be able to make in the future, but you'll take it now. And then we'll just keep it on our platform forever. But what you've kind of seen, it's kind of starting to break a little bit. Like Warner Brothers, who's trying to get off a lot of debt, you know, they're like leasing Westworld and all this stuff to different platforms.
Yeah.
And it's to try to make some money back. So I think you're going to see a lot of content be across a lot more platforms. But it's a wild time of, you know, 6 months from now, there could be a whole different business model. And but the same answer we'll get from executives here is we just don't know how much money we have for the year. And let's kick this into the new year and all the same bullshit out there.
I do also wonder because, you know, now a lot of us that grew up with computers and knowing how to use them and knowing how to use, you know, strictly very legal sites like LimeWire. I wonder, like, because all of this is coming out to basically more than what cable costs, the older generation's not going to do a lot of very legal stuff. But I think at some point, if you can't really afford getting it, but you still want to watch it, like I said, a lot of us around our age and a bit older know how to use these things and they could use these things.
Oh,
so I wonder if that has any type of effect at all, if it will. I mean, that'd be years down the making, whether or not that loses them money and whether they already make a choice on how to stop that. But I'm just wondering if that can do anything, really.
Well, there is a couple like off-market devices that I've heard of like you pay $250 straight up and you can jailbreak and get every device, every movie, every live.
I'll tell you this, you don't got to pay that much to jailbreak, but I never done that before, I promise. Anyway.
Yeah, well, that's all the jokes online too. Going back to your point is because of the Peacock thing of like, you know, Crack Streams and Stream East is going to have like a field day on Saturday of just, you know, illegally showing the Chiefs game.
And also like on TikTok too. How many times do people just do live TikToks and just put their phone in front of a screen? Like I've seen it with like MMA fights, like for UFC, instead of buying it, some people just have it rolling on TikTok. And
the funniest was the guy that pretended like he was playing UFC.
That guy was good.
That's how I watched the Conor McGregor Mayweather fight.
That's always good. Yeah, I got this. So my last question on the entertainment front, because I am a giant nerd. I love Marvel. I love Star Wars. And Disney has fucking destroyed everything that I've loved. And I've noticed that a lot of it is because the storytelling, I don't know if they just, the people that are doing it now either don't understand the properties, don't give a shit, or maybe have an agenda for what they're doing, right? Because, you know, Dave and I here, we've had our issues with woke stuff before. We're not fans of woke shit. And you know, and my biggest issue is, I don't care if you want to put messaging in, right? Hollywood's always leaned left. There's always been messages, but they were much more subtle about it. It wasn't the story. It was a part of the story that they told, right? And even if it was the story, it was written in well. Like, you know, WALL-E 100% is about global warming and pollution. It's going to fuck up the planet, right? It's one of my favorite Disney movies. I'm not big on like climate change and everything like that, but I will watch WALL-E every single day of the week because it was a great story. You know, is there, if you were to put the blame on the writing right now, because like I said, I'm not a big fan of the writing. I think very few movies and TV shows are written very well right now. Is there a problem with the writers, or is there more of a problem with the way that the studios and producers want the writers to write these things? Because I just see such a lack of creativity. Like, everyone wants diversity. Everyone wants LGBTQ+. But then it's just like, insert. Don't make it, don't make the person interesting. Don't make, you know, make that their whole entire character arc. And that's been like one of my biggest turnoffs there. So if you were to sit there and, you know, humor me with this, is there more of a blame on the studios wanting this and forcing the writers to put these things in? Is it the writers doing it and not being able to tell stories anymore? Combination of both? Like, where would you see this? Or am I just an asshole?
I don't think you're an asshole. I think, you know, I think what's important is I think everyone wants to be able to see themselves on the screen in some fashion, regardless of religion and background. I think that's always a good thing to aspire to. And I think even Bob Iger said this a couple months ago or weeks ago, sorry, but you know, you're supposed to be storytellers first, and you're not in charge to send a message first. You want to try to sprinkle that in. And I think, you know, with all the things that have gone on in the last 3 years, I think it's safe to say maybe we've overcorrected a little bit of what we think we want to tell in these stories and the tinkering we've made. You know, I'm a Marvel fan through and through. I've been a little disappointed myself.
My protest with the seeing myself in it, I don't want to see myself in any fucking superheroes because I'm an idiot, right? Like, I don't want to see, I don't think anyone should want to, like, I am that superhero. No, you want to aspire to be that superhero. Like, the one that worked was Peter Parker and Batman. Those were always the two that were kind of like the common person become superhero. Everyone else, it was like Thor. I'm not Thor. He's a fucking god. Like, I would love to try to be a god, but that's Thor, Superman. Like, and I think that might be where a lot of things have gone wrong, especially with supernatural storytelling, right? We don't need to see ourselves in supernatural stuff. And I think if a writer is trying to write themselves in, then they're not creating a story. They're creating an autobiography where it's like, if you're writing and, you know, I write, I'm been working on a novel for years and things like that. And when I'm writing my characters are doing their own thing. I'm not telling my characters what to do as I write. As I'm writing, they're doing things organically within the book. And I feel like some of it's just been forced. And like you said, it might have just been a potential overcorrection. It just feels so forced right now. And I think that's one of my biggest issues.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a few things. I think that's a fair assessment. I think, you know, up until recently, there was no financial data to say that you were right in your exhaustion. I think now the last year has shown, you know, the returns haven't been as expected and kind of the word of mouth hasn't been as expected. And so I think, not saying that we're going to overcorrect the other way, but I think we've started to, what I hope is a leveling out of just getting back to what we like and, you know, kind of what we want to see on screen.
Yeah.
What was I going to say? I had another point in there. I mean, I do think that, just lost my train of thought. God damn it, Questa.
Well, I'm sorry.
I can jump in. I can jump into something real quick. I also feel like the financial bloat on a lot of these movies is also what's killing them because they need to make so much in order to make their money back. And I mean, you look at my favorite movie of the year was Godzilla Minus One. I thought it was fantastic.
Was
I love that movie.
$15 million they used? 13 less to
than,
make that?
Less than that. I think it's $13 million.
Yeah.
And it made a ton of money because it was a damn good movie. A damn good Godzilla movie with human parts that you just love.
And
which
Sound
is
of Freedom is another good example. That Sound of Freedom was $19 million and they made over 100.
Yeah. But that's the thing. And I feel like the bloat in a lot of these movies, you know, it's like $200 million is what's killing them because you could make a good amount of money, but if you don't make enough to break even, then it's just hurting you.
Yeah.
Yeah. I got it back now. I would say that, like, you know, when we think of superheroes and supernatural and stuff, also the problem is its own success. Of like those movies from 2016 to 2020, really were the only movies that seemed to make money. Mm-hmm. And now what you see is you have 7 or 8 just getting churned out every year. And so the story of a superhero more often than not in a movie is pretty much the same. Mm-hmm. So you're just trying to find a way to reinvent the wheel. And right now I think you're just kind of waiting for the next thing. And we might not be able to hit like what's the new take on a superhero.
Hey, Craig, can you just go to the studio and just bring a stack of comic books and just fucking throw it at them and say, read this and put that on, like, make a version of this, because that's what they were doing for 4 years was kind of, you know, bringing the source material in a way to the screen that even nerds could go, they missed this, but it was still solid. Wait, we have our complaints, but they kept it there. Now they're just like, source material, we don't care. And normally I don't blame people for not listening to the fans for some things, right? Because fans are stupid. But there are times where the fans are saying enough of the same thing that I feel like you should just be like, maybe we're a little, maybe we should go back and reassess here.
Yep. I will say, if we can, play this back years from now, maybe I'll be wrong, but if we can survive Deadpool, which I think will be great, but if we can survive 2024, I think the next 5 to 6 years of superhero movies are going to be great. We're going to get the legacy characters that we want. I feel like in Marvel's defense that they are kind of listening to fans. I mean, just in reading the trades, they've kind of completely rehauled their television department. They go on a retreat every year to kind of break down. And for the first time, it was a real all hands on deck. What can we do? I trust in Kevin Feige. I'm also like a loser. I'll be at every Thursday night show when it stinks. But I do think that's the one company. I can't speak for Star Wars and Kathleen Kennedy. I can't speak for.
Oh, yeah, because they're making Mandalorian and Grogu for no fucking reason.
Well, which is so sad, because it's like, if that was 5 years ago, I would have been like geeking out. But
if Grogu wasn't still a infant and has done a damn thing at all, like Grogu is just, they just want to sell more Grogu products instead of, and that's, again, that's the problem. The Mandalorian has had no development, none whatsoever, and any little development he had was taken back because it became the story of Bo-Katan in season 3. It was like, so it's like, and then Grogu just sits there and is like, he gets one extra telekinetic thing a season.
Yeah, it went from being this cool, off galaxy, don't need to know Star Wars, to
Wild
being
a West type of thing, yeah,
to being a bloated sequel of the Clone Wars, which, you know, to each their own. I'm just interested to see, just to go back to Marvel and stuff like that, of, what does the Fantastic Four look like? What does the X-Men look like now? Finally, nice to see under the Marvel shield. So,
I do want to say this. I never liked Grogu, for the main reason being
you did hate
that
him.
He is just Gizmo. But not even as cute as Gizmo.
He's green Gizmo.
He's not even as cute as Gizmo. So what are you going crazy for?
Yeah, but Gizmo couldn't use the Force.
Who cares? He killed gremlins and gremlins too. Like, he shot pencils at him. He was awesome.
He is. And yeah, so I hope you're right. I hope you're right about Marvel, because I just hope that they reset and maybe read 2 or 3 of the comic books of the characters that they're trying to do, and stop pushing side characters, right? Like, Iron Man wasn't a super main guy, but at least he had a good long run of comics.
Well, yeah.
They're pushing people that have been failed in comic books that have multiple cancellations. And it's kind of like unnecessary, because most comic book fans don't like half these people. Yeah. And they're turning Silver Surfer, my favorite hero, into a woman.
Well, actually,
my favorite character too.
to be fair though, I heard it might not be Norrin. It might not actually be Silver Surfer. It'd be another. It's going to be another.
Don't do it, because it's just
the Silver Surfer cool.
Damn it. There's one.
And I will say this. The thing about Iron Man, he was never really like the big character in the comics. He wasn't huge. No. But that Iron Man movie was fantastic. And that's why he got so
He was popular, and he had a main long run in comics, though.
But he wasn't as big as the big Marvel.
Cap. The Cap was the big guy.
Spidey. Yeah.
Spidey is Marvel. So that's proven.
Well, it's been a tough 3 years in this industry. I got to think, for Marvel, it probably has not gone the way that they've wanted. They had COVID, which probably made a lot of rearranging, a lot of concessions and stuff you wanted to make. I think, you hate to say it to Chadwick Boseman passing away, probably threw a huge wrench in the bigger MCU plans that they had.
And now Jonathan Majors doesn't help at all either with him.
Exactly. It kind of feels like they can't, feels like it's just been one thing after another that, maybe outside of casting Brie Larson as Captain Marvel, has been out of their control.
And I also think they got a little bit too ambitious with it, especially with seemingly writing the same character for every single action.
They were all Chris Pratt.
Yeah, the movie's
trying to be Chris Pratt.
Since Guardians came out, it seems like every character is comic relief. Every character has some kind of witty line. When it's just like, that's not necessarily what made things so big for Marvel in the first place.
So, yeah. But Craig, I hope you're right. And I hope they bring back my childhood. I hope Disney stops ruining my childhood. And, there's rumors that they might buy property to Dragon Ball. And I will absolutely, I don't go to protests. I will be standing the fuck outside of Disney Studios every day holding a sign. I don't care if I'm alone. I will start a protest if they even attempt to buy it. So,
Disney was in charge during most of the Infinity Saga.
Yeah,
they were. Since then, they've gone downhill. So maybe they can be redeemed. So I just want to quickly, because I don't want to leave you too long, because we've actually went pretty far right now. But yeah, I just want to touch, because you're a sports fan. You know, you came on the Sports Opinion show back in the day. I want to touch on some recent things that have happened in football with the coaches. I know you're a Broncos fan. I don't know if you want to talk about the Broncos right now. Bill Belichick announced that, you know, he's going to be leaving. It seems like Harbaugh is going to be leaving Michigan. Pete Carroll retiring. Nick Saban retiring. What do you think is going to go on with the coaching carousel? Are Carroll and Saban going to stay retired? Where's Belichick going? What's Harbaugh doing, in your opinion?
I think if I'm Belichick, I think that, you know, it'd be a hell of a move to go from Mac Jones to Justin Herbert. You know, everything I've kind of read, it seems like Belichick's not done coaching. He wants to keep going. I think of all the jobs you look at, it's got to be that job just because of the quarterback. I also think Harbaugh would love to be there too. He played there for a little bit in San Diego. I think that the most slam dunk one is I think Dan Quinn goes to Seattle. He was a defensive coordinator there when they won a Super Bowl. But it's kind of feel like the last 48 hours have been like every time I look up my phone, another legend is gone. And I kind of think, you know, more so with Harbaugh and Saban, it's just the landscape of college athletics is changing so much. And I watched Saban today on SportsCenter, and he just kind of admitted it himself of just like the grind of what today's sport is just kind of is harder to recover from.
Dealing with that NIL now can't be fun. NIL stuff, and Florida State just got slammed by the NCAA for NIL infractions. And I feel like a lot of the times these big schools should just be like, no, we defer this back, because there's been really no clear cut direction on what to do with the NIL. It's been an absolute shit show.
Yeah. And looking at just kind of the rest of those vacancies, I mean, New England, I got to think if you're New England, that there seems to be a contingency plan for what's his name that was on the staff, Mayo, but I think you got to just go for Mike Vrabel now.
Vrabel seems like a natural guy to bring in there.
The sinister me, my girlfriend and her family are diehard Pats fans, so I would love for Josh McDaniels to come right back in and make for another 3 years.
I can't imagine wanting that Patriots job right now. I'm not going to lie to you. That team isn't very good.
What about a guy like Antonio Pierce? Where does he end up? Because it doesn't look like the Raiders are going to keep him.
Which I think would be silly.
Insane. Yeah. So where do you think Antonio Pierce lands?
I don't think he lands at a head coaching job at all. I think you're going to see him get a very lucrative head coach or defensive coordinator position like he was before.
Maybe to the Giants with, Wink going on.
Yeah.
Going
out. I mean, come home. I mean, that's the reason why Josh McDaniels hated him, because, you know, when he gave his speech to the team, he basically ripped on the Patriots because of that Giants team. But it just blows my mind. The Raiders, you know, the Raiders who don't have a ton of money are already paying Gruden, and then they're paying McDaniels. I mean, just go with the guy that's already in house. You made this mistake once with what's his name, Steve Scarf.
Agnolo. No, I can't remember.
Sarkisian. Sark.
No, it wasn't Sark. From 2 years ago that took him.
Yeah,
to
I can't remember his name, but yeah, no, I know.
Yeah, I don't know.
He's the special teams coordinator in Green Bay now.
Who else are we thinking about? What about Gruden potentially going to NOLA on the staff?
That would be great. I mean, he's said that he wants to bring everyone into the light with the NFL. So I'd love to see what that's about. And then did you see the old Golden State Warriors executive is now in charge of operations for the Commanders?
I didn't see that at all. And God, they need. Here's the thing. I don't call them the Commanders. They're the Redskins until they get a real name. I don't care if that offends anybody. The Commanders is one of the worst fucking names in sports. Just, you know, I liked it better when they were the Washington football team. And, you know, I like
and
that
their uniforms much better. Terrible.
The only thing that's nice is the font of the W is fine. Outside of that, everything else sucks about their whole entire scheme. So they need to fix that up. Trying to think.
Wonder though if the New York Giants came out today, you'd be on a podcast ripping that name to shit.
The Giants? That's an awful. It is a stupid name. But you know what though? It's a traditional name, and they were the New York Football Giants. That is their actual name, the New York Football Giants, to be different than the New York Giants of baseball.
And I also feel like if you have a good scheme to go around your name, like it like the Giants with their throwback uniforms, those look nice. Those are pretty crisp. Yeah. If the Commanders had nice uniforms and things look nice around that whole entire scheme, then it's not that bad of a name anymore because the things look nice around it. But it just looks ugly. It's just not good, especially compared to the Redskins uniforms. Those are nice.
Those are legendary.
So, yeah. So it's if you have a bad name, but your scheming around it is good, then it's okay. You can live through it.
So I do want to touch on your Broncos. They're going to cut Russell Wilson. Who comes in? What are they doing?
You know, I always say this, if you're on the boat that Russell Wilson shouldn't be cut, I don't think you've watched enough Bronco football this year. I truly believe we were schemed up as if we had a rookie quarterback of like, if our first read isn't there, we're checking down and running,
which is crazy. Cause you have Cortland Sutton and Jerry Jeudy. They are really good.
At the same time though, I truly believe that Russell Wilson at this stage in his life can't see the middle of the field down the field. We had 18 completions of intermediate passing in the middle of the field.
Wow.
I am not a fan of Jerry Jeudy, but I will give him the benefit of the doubt of like, he just was open so many times and not seen. I think the one thing I'm happy about the last 18 months of my Broncos is bad organizations doubled down on the mistakes out of pride. Mm-hmm. And there's not been one time in the last 18 months that we've done that, you know? And so to cut Russell Wilson and eat that money, which would be the most dead money for one NFL player on one team. But this year, the Rams have $85 million in dead money and still made the playoffs.
Yeah.
You got to hit on those fourth and fifth round picks. But I envision we're going to go with Jared Stidham, QB1 in 2024, and it's going to be probably J.J. McCarthy, you know, at 16 that we're picking, I think it is, or 12.
Suck for Shador. Just suck for Shador.
Oh, I'm not a fan.
I like Shador.
Oh my God, Mr. 4-8. I don't need that in my life.
I mean, though, but he also had me, you, David, your girlfriend, and maybe your friend down the block blocking for him. Okay, like he had. That was the. Not only did he have the worst defense in football, he had one of the worst offensive lines in football.
That's fair. I mean, I'm willing to pause my take until seeing Colorado this year, I suppose. But that's what I think. I was disappointed to see Michael Penix struggle against an NFL caliber defense on Monday because I do think that he's in play for the Broncos at 12.
I think May is in play from North Carolina.
I don't necessarily love watching J.J. McCarthy meditate before games after Russell Wilson did the same thing last year. That gives me PTSD.
And J.J. walks up and says, Broncos country, let's ride. You're just going to start throwing things.
And he's the type of guy that will. Like, let's be honest.
And then it's just like, I don't know. Like, at one point, I was Broncos were 1-5, and just watching Caleb Williams, and I'm like, I could be wrong. I'm happy I don't have him either. The painted nails and the crying.
I don't like Caleb Williams one bit. He's super immature. I think if he can make more money in the NIL and stay, then stay and grow up a little bit because I want full control. I'm not going to go play for this team. I want, fuck you. How are you going to be a 20-year-old trying to lead men when you're a baby? Like he's a grown baby. I don't like it at all.
My sleeper pick of that draft is Hartman, the Notre Dame, who was at Wake Forest.
Sam Hartman?
Yeah, that's my guy. You 3 years from now, you'll play. Next time I come on this podcast when I'm 37, 38 years old, I'm like, I told you he was going to win a Super Bowl.
Maybe that would be such a take if that happens.
Yeah,
you're definitely going to play this back and be like the now multimillionaire Craig Leppert, chairman and founder of the not for profit Shadow Jumpers, is.
or we're like. Now we Zoom live to inmate 64663 in Los Angeles County Jail.
And me and David are still making absolutely no money doing podcasts. Like, we're still just doing it for fun. But yeah, no, I think it's interesting. So would you take this trade? We'll give you Bryce Huff. You cut Russell Wilson and get him to re-sign like a backup deal. And then we'll also take Jerry Jeudy off your hands for Bryce Huff and those two guys. We'll use Russell as our backup, Jerry Jeudy as our number two with Garrett. And we give you the best pass rusher in the NFL because fuck.
I mean, if you eat some of that contract, I would give it to you.
The Jets might, but I mean, I don't want him to start. But if Rodgers goes down again, I would take Russell Wilson over fucking Zach Wilson.
You think I throw things when Aaron Rodgers runs out and that other Achilles snaps? I can only imagine because it's coming.
We made the joke of Matt Leary, where I said we get five snaps from him.
Here's the thing. You can ask David. You can ask anyone that asked me about it. When we got Aaron Rodgers, I was like, you're pumped. I'm like, nope. Seasoned Jets fan. What can go wrong will go wrong. And what happened four plays in? I wasn't even surprised. He hurt himself. I looked and I'm like, Jets. This is the most Jets thing ever. The 90s uniforms, Aaron, like the most epic come out scene. Like it looked like a WWE entrance the way he came out with that flag. Yeah. It was like the whole, they should have played Real American by the Hulk. I am a real American.
I was in JFK. I was in travel hell. My flight had got canceled. Me and my girlfriend went to the bar. We're like drinking wine. There's a Jet fan at the bar.
No.
He went down grabbing his leg. It was the saddest sight. This guy just ordered so much. He drank so much.
That might be the one time people actually felt bad for Jets fans right there. Everyone usually thinks like they hate us, but it's like that one time it's like, ah, man.
One of my favorite memes I've seen going around is someone said they like put in the AI art thing is like they put different NFL fans in there. And every single time they put the New York Jets, it was like some anime girl crying. Like, it was never anything else. It was like they were always crying.
Here's the thing, and you know, I don't want to put this voodoo out, and I'm sorry, Joe, if you ever listen to the show, but until Joe Namath is not on this planet anymore, the Jets could never do anything good. His deal with the devil has doomed the Jets to always suck. Like, we can't win with him still being alive. The devil won't allow it. He made a deal with the devil. Like, he just needs to let his soul go to damnation for that Super Bowl, and just let us be good, Joe. We love you, but it's time. It's time, Joe.
What deal John Elway made with the devil in 2016 to get that Super Bowl 50. I would like to note just for the listeners, I'm really excited to be on this podcast because last time I was on an Alex Cuesta podcast was in 2018. And those of you might not remember, he told me the Syracuse Orange men were going to win 3 football games that year. And they ended up having their best season in like since then, winning 10 games. So I'm hoping this year is the voodoo, the good juju that I need for a good season.
And we'll see, because the last few years they've actually had really good draft classes and they've been balls. So it's like, I don't understand what is going on in Syracuse. Like when they have good draft classes, for whatever reason, they like miss on all their players. I don't know what's going on.
Yeah. Well, we'll see. New coach. It's a transfer portal. Got a quarterback from Ohio State. Probably isn't a good sign that he left Ohio State to begin with. Not talked about enough, but you know, we'll see if the domes rock in this summer, this fall.
That'll be interesting. Let's bring up the McPherson and McNabb times. Let's get the Orange Men back into the national prominence, baby.
Yeah, torn away jerseys, but they were in the 90s.
Yeah, they were pretty dope. But I mean, let Rutgers go there first. Go Rutgers.
Keep chopping, baby. Piscataway.
Yeah, buddy.
Yeah.
All right, Craig. Thanks for coming on, brother. You have his non sequitur.
I have my non sequitur. I love this one. Okay. So recently in the news, I hope you saw it, Craig, but in New York, there is some tunneling going on.
Yes, I did.
So my question is, if you were to dig a tunnel underneath any area, city, town, whatever, what tunnel, where would you dig it and why would you dig it? What would you use the underground tunnel for?
I don't even need to think about it. I would build a tunnel from my apartment here in Glendale, California, to Chatsworth, California, about 15.2 miles away. That's the closest Applebee's in my area. And it drives me insane. The closest Applebee's in Los Angeles is 15.2 miles away.
That might be the greatest answer.
It costs me more to Uber to and from my apartment than the bill. It pissed me the fuck off.
And coming from Manchester, where we went to like Applebee's every other weekend, like you are now deprived. Oh my God, Dave.
My favorite thing now as a 34-year-old is me and my buddy. We don't go bar hopping anymore. We go a chain restaurant hopping. So we go to Applebee's, Fridays, Dave and Buster's.
That's awesome.
I try to stay as much New Jersey as I can out
there. That's incredible. Dave, where would you tunnel?
I didn't really give this one much thought. I'm not going to lie to you. I just like the question itself. I think I would go under a city like Miami or something like that, because like that is just an interesting area. Imagine the things you hear above you in Miami or in Atlanta, Georgia.
He would end up underneath the synagogue in both.
Well, did you hear that guy on Twitter like months ago was like,
I hear Yiddish underneath me.
And then afterwards, it's like, I fucking told you so. So my answer would be many years ago. This would have been a many years ago answer, not current, but I would have dug a tunnel over to California to go under Hugh Hefner's house and to find a way to get into the mansion without having to be invited. Before, he didn't like titties, because now there's like no titties allowed, I guess, or whatever. Maybe they still hold the parties and have titties, but Playboy is a lot softer now. But that would have been my answer. I would have found my way from Jersey and tunneled to Cali underneath the Playboy mansion.
But you're a father now, right?
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely. I said your mother.
Two girls, too. They're going to go nowhere near California. Oh, man. But yeah. So now Craig's trying to get me in trouble. But but Craig, thanks for coming on, brother. It's always a good time.
Yeah, thank you guys for having me. I really appreciate it. Thanks for it's always good to see you and catch up as friends. And thanks for taking interest in Shadow Jumpers.
Of course.
You know, like I said, I talked to you guys on a podcast or you Quest, you know, back in 2018, and just so proud to see your success and now bringing, you know, Make a Wish Kids on to help you out with this podcast is awesome. And
you know, it's just a cool talking about David?
Yeah, David's a Make-A-Wish kid. You don't explain the joke. You just let it happen.
Oh, I don't know. I mean, David's Make-A-Wish. Lep does Make-A-Wish things. I don't know where he's going.
It's great to see your success and just all the work you guys are putting in. And I can't wait to see where it goes. So
absolutely. We appreciate it. So once again, go to shadowjumpers.org. You'll see the Spin Away the Sun link up top, or just donate in general. Go there. Please donate. It's to a great cause. And if you heard everything that Craig does here, it's only going to get bigger. So please help and join in and give people some fun. And, you know, so they could do great things. They can get help with their medical expenses and stuff. Dave, do you have anything to say before we get out of here?
If you want to put where you would tunnel under, please comment on this episode, because I would love to know.
Yes, yes. Maybe I'll add that to you. Where would you tunnel under? Maybe we should, Dave, we should put your non sequitur in tweets all the time and let people answer that in a tweet where they would do. All right. So everyone, we'll be back next week. If you like what you heard today, like, share, follow, subscribe, rate 5 stars, Spotify and iTunes. Spread this word of mouth. Look for us on the socials at the Alex Cuesta Show. We'll be back next week, y'all. See you later. Oh, man.